Dear Excellencies, dear Mayor, dear Governor, distinguished guests, dear Professor Segers, dear family of Professor Segers, it's my great pleasure to welcome you here today to the inaugural lecture of Mathieu Segers. My name is Rianne Letschert and I'm the Rector Magnificus of the University. I'm sorry I was already standing here. Normally it's a little bit of shorter musical interruption, but it was beautiful. Thank you very much. It's not the right word, interruption, anyway. Many fateful things can happen during puberty. Falling in with a bad crowd, embarrassing tattoos. I'm not sure if you have them, Mathieu. Drugs. You, Mathieu, you developed a debilitating addiction to Europe. You were 15 when the European Summit was held here in Maastricht. You were fascinated by what you intuited to be a momentous event in world history. Even though you were so enthusiastic and it happened barely 100 meters from your house, all you saw was security, barriers, and fences. What you felt was distance. You took it very badly, being excluded from this historic political moment. And judging by your CV, you never really got over it. Joking aside, your commitment to addressing Europe's problems in the context of the history of European integration has made you relevant far beyond the academic and political community. Europe in a globalizing world is, of course, one of our research themes and one of the reasons why we are especially happy to have you here in Maastricht University. Your research, also in very practical terms, is needed. So we consider ourselves lucky that you have become a researcher in the first place, because your passion for politics, combined with your Bourgondische flair and talent for the grand gesture, make you also a natural diplomat. You have proven that you fit right in Den Haag. You were a policy advisor at the Ministry of Finance and at the Ministry of Social Affairs and Employment, and even before that, you had completed internships in government institutions, and you were flirting with the idea of becoming a civil servant. Your supervisor in Nijmegen at the time worried that you would be lost to academia, having come to realize that wielding power is more fun than studying it. Whichever path you would choose, he had absolute confidence in your ability in the field of international politics. His only worry was whether your success would leave you with enough time to stay abreast of European football. That's what he told me. In the end, you completed your doctoral scripsi on the Treaty of Rome in 2000. You completed your PhD within 4 years and stayed at Nijmegen as assistant professor of international relations and European integration before editing the European Diaries of Max Constam. The early 2010s saw you go to Harvard University, Fulbright Schumann Fellow there, and to the University of Oxford as a senior research fellow. And after 8 years as assistant professor of European integration and international relations at Utrecht University, you finally made the right choice. You came to Maastricht. Now, since 2016, you have been serving as dean of our university college, United Nations College. Well, you give it a few years, huh? And as professor of contemporary European history and European integration. Now, in Nijmegen, they thought you were too much of a historian for a political scientist. And in Utrecht, they thought you were too much of a political scientist for a historian. Now, we here think you are the perfect mix. Now, in keeping with your dislike of barriers and fences, you do not lock yourself into the ivory tower of academia. You share your expertise with the public as a columnist for the Financiële Dagblad and the Groene Amsterdammer, and as author of some very well-received books on Europe, one of which, Journey to the Continent, The Netherlands and European Integration from 1950 to the Present, very long titles these academics always have, was even awarded the Prinsjes Boekenprijs for the best political book of 2013. Now, another example of your civic engagement, particularly close also to my heart, is Maastricht Working on Europe, where you serve as chair of the academic board and are also a vital member of the core team. Here I got some first-hand experience of how nice it is to work with you. It is clear for everyone to see how passionate you are about the vision behind this project. And as it happens today, one of its initiatives, Studio Europe, has opened at the Onze Lieve Vrouwenplein. It's a workshop where academics, students, experts, and social entrepreneurs come together to debate and develop ideas, but also to make their knowledge available to the public, to make Europe relevant to its citizens. And I think it's also a great illustration of how you are a perfect fit with UM's vision and how UM also enables you to follow your passion. So when the municipality decided to fund a Europe chair at UM to tackle questions on European integration and all its potentialities, implications and corollaries, it was clear who would be the ideal candidate to help this chair come to life. At the same time, you also continue to share your expertise with the Dutch governments. Since 2013, you have been chair of the Advisory Commission on Archival Affairs of the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and now you also serve as a committee member of the Advisory Council on International Affairs. And more than 2 years ago, you were seconded to the WRR, the Netherlands Scientific Council for Government Policy, to research the future of the EU and how it can be transformed to meet citizens' needs and expectations. We hope you've sorted that out by now. That's very helpful also for our project. Now, at the WRR, you are appreciated as a meticulous, deep thinker, an expert, but also much loved as someone who connects and integrates people. With your humor and southern charm, you make everyone feel at ease and welcome, whether Den Haag is their natural habitat or not. You yourself have also fallen for the southern charm, seeing as that you have been going on holiday to Sicily every year for the last decade. There's a suspicion that you were Italian in a previous life. But I don't want to overstate the cosmopolitan element here. Ondanks al je bijdrage aan het Europese belang, ben en blijf je toch ook een geboren en getogen Maastrichtenaar. Je bijdrage aan de stad zelf zijn dan ook niet alleen je werk als dean van UCM, maar ook 4 nieuwe Maastrichtenaren. Je vrouw Marel en je kinderen Sophia, Orfeo en Gloria. Dus dit is voor jullie denk ik ook een hele bijzondere dag vandaag. The 15-year-old who was so close yet so far from European politics has become someone who has reduced distances. The distance between established and new colleagues, the distance between research and practice, between Maastricht and Den Haag, between politics and history, between Europe and Europeans. Now, normally, I would now give the floor to the professor to give an inaugural address. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to give the floor first to our mayor, who would like to speak some words also to you.
Yeah, Mathieu, I don't know if you're very happy with this offer, because I suppose you're sort of wobbling on your chair to start your, a few minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, dear Mathieu, it is an important weekend for Maastricht, because it's the first time that we are organizing the Maastricht Europe Days. It is a new event, and it has to do with the birthplace of the European Union, of course, because we want to revitalize our union. And this conference also underscores the close ties between Maastricht University, the province of Limburg, and the city of Maastricht. And of course, the climate of this European weekend is undoubtedly the inauguration of Professor Mathieu Zegers. Of course, I called you this afternoon, I'm sorry for that, our knuffel professor. I won't translate because otherwise it goes all over the world, but we are very fond of you. It is your inauguration, but it's also the launching of the Europe Chair. It was mentioned before. And by establishing this chair, the city of Maastricht emphasizes that it is the city of the European citizens. Just like Brussels is the city of European politics and Luxembourg is the city of the European law. The city has therefore offered the university this chair as a sign that we are united in our mission to continue the process of internationalization both in the city and in the university. And I would like to express my wholehearted agreement with what Rianne already told about you. There's no one better suited to this chair than Mathieu Zegers. He quite literally witnessed the birth of the European Union from his teenage bedroom in 1991. And he has seen for himself what it was like to live in a city surrounded by foreign countries in the days when there were barricades at the borders. Mathieu, you probably also remember what we saw those days in all the local rooms in the houses here in the city, three wallets, one with the Belgian franc, one with the German mark, and one with the Dutch guilder. And you will have seen, of course, with your own eyes that nowhere is the cross-border movement of people, goods, and also services so intense as in your regions, such as in our South Limburg. And for you, and for all people who live in the EU region, Europe is not just a fictional construct, it's everyday reality. It's picked, and this picked your curiosity as a scholar. But there's another and more convincing reason to appoint Professor Mathieu Segers as the holder of this chair. Ladies and gentlemen, as Professor of Contemporary European History and European Integration, my God, he has gained international renown as an authority on earlier and also present day developments in Europe. His publications show the way throughout Europe, and Brussels and other European capitals listen to what he has to say. And it's no surprise that he has worked as an advisor, Janne told already, for several ministers and the Netherlands Scientific Council for Government Policy. Still, he does. And that is in part because of Professor Segers is not the sort of scholar who locks himself in an academic ivory tower. This is the Sinterklaas or Black Pete. Black Pete. So no offense for who is in the ivory tower. I'm sure this will be useful also. But this is not our Mathieu. We only need to consider his widely acclaimed columns and books. He is a prominent voice in the ongoing discourse on political, economic, and cultural trends and developments in Europe. And as the mayor of a city working to build a European identity, I regard Mathieu Segers as an inspiration and important source of information. And apart from all that, he is still just a Maastrichtjungske. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm convinced of the enormous academic demand for a chair such as this one. And it will help to make Maastricht's knowledge about Europe visitable and appreciated. And that knowledge is both unique and of an excellent quality. And in addition, this chair will help us to build the bridge between academia on the one hand and the public and politics on the other. For example, by supporting public debates, and publications that reach out to broad segments of society. And that is why Europe needs this chair. But it is also important to Maastricht for yet another reason. It puts our city firmly and permanently on the map as a place where dialogue on Europe is being conducted. The birthplace of the European Union is the city where ideas about Europe are generated and where we are working continuously to build Europe's future, not specific for us elderly people, but for our youth. In doing so, we underscore Maastricht's significance as an international university city, something that supports both the university as the local government. And of course, this helps for business and tourism. But mind you, the latter is only a byproduct. The real motivation is to revitalize the European ideal of prosperity and security for all European Union citizens. Mathieu, congratulations so many with your inauguration and of course also with the launching of this Europe chair. I congratulate your wife and your children and the rest of your family. It is a huge achievement in the academic world to be as well inaugural recipient and also have two chairs to look after, as I understood. So there's lots to do for you. We are looking forward to hearing about your methods and your aims in your inaugural address in a few minutes now. On behalf of the municipal government of Maastricht and all citizens of Europe, 480 million, I would like to wish you every possible luck. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, our mayor. Mathieu, now it's time for you to climb up the stairs. You will see what that means for your inaugural address.
We'll close this one. Dear Excellencies, dear Mayor, dear Governor, dear Rector Magnificus, dear members of the board of the Executive Board of the University, dear Vice Rector, dear members of Parliament, dear colleagues, friends and family, ladies and gentlemen. This autumn we commemorate that World War I ended 100 years ago. According to the great British historian Norman Davies, the First World War marks the beginning of a period of 75 years, the period during which Europe was divided by the longest of its civil wars, lasting from 1914 until 1990. The longest of Europe's civil wars only ended in 1990 with the peace treaty with and regarding Germany. And it was this peace treaty that put an end to the order of Yalta and Potsdam and reunited Germany. The peace treaty of 1990 laid the foundations for the end of the Cold War and the reunion of Europe, facilitated by the process of European integration and re-enshrined in the Treaty on European Union signed in this city 27 years ago. In 2016, at the occasion of the 25th anniversary of the Treaty of Maastricht, Federica Mogherini, the High Representative of the European Union for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy, gave a speech here in Maastricht. There she is. In her speech, Mogherini concisely summarized the grand ambitions which were put black on white back then, and I quote her, Federica Mogherini. "The Treaty of Maastricht was a revolution. For the first time in the history of the world, building peace became the aspiration of an entire continent," unquote. Federica Mogherini is a child of the 1990s, just like many others gathered in this church here today, including myself. Mogherini was born in 1973 and went to university in the early 1990s. In her speech in Maastricht, 2 years ago, Mogherini recalled the spirit of that time, and she said, and I quote her again, "I remember very well the hopes of my generation at the end of the Cold War, the bold hopes and expectations for a new global order," unquote. I remember this too, these hopeful and free, and yes, in many ways, truly multicultural years. This lucky in-between of contemporary European history, the years between the fall of the Berlin Wall and 9/11. But today, the memory of those open years often seems fading away. Ladies and gentlemen, what Norman Davies called Europe's longest civil war started with the First World War, the Great War, more than 100 years ago, in 1914. And up to the present day, however, nobody knows exactly why this happened. In spite of libraries filled with research and historical reconstruction on the topic, we still are quite in the dark with regard to that crucial question. Why? Why did Europe start the war that ended peace? And looking back at that fatal moment in European history, the French novelist Roger Martin Dugard, during the 1920s and 1930s, wrote his great family epic entitled Les Thibauts. Hundreds and hundreds of pages of gripping prose in which he describes the incomprehensible rally around fake news and real bluff in the run-up to World War I. This maddening rat race of grandstanding of nations and certain individuals, which promptly became too violent and too powerful for Europe. In the last part of his book, Martin Dugard describes the summer of 1914, during which literally nobody could escape the great transition from peace and freedom to war and coercion. This transition, which would convert the Europe of before the Great War into the Welt von gestern, a sweet but lost world. This transition during which everything happens as if the individual, while living in peace, had forgotten something essential about the social condition, namely that he is powerless without others, and that where others are powerless, he is too. The nearness of others characterizes European life. Contemporary European history starts with the interweaving of families and regions, the realities of the local community, which encapsulate a pan-European history not of nations, but of families. Or as Sigmund Freud once said, all history is family history. Europe's future is anchored not so much in Brussels, but in these regional, provincial places. These places where official histories get messed up. These places where family ties are old and often characterized by migration, and where diversity inspires, but also strikes terror. These elegant small cities, provincial capitals, where modesty and pride compete for dominance, and change of events are set in motion. Cities like Sarajevo and Maastricht. Federica Mogherini chose this city, our city, that sometimes in moments of particular self-confidence refers to itself as the balcony of Europe, het balkon van Europa, to remind us that, and I quote, it is up to us to decide what happens next in Europe. And she furthermore stressed, and I quote her again, it is us and only us who can make the difference in the Balkans. And she probably was right. Mogherini chose our balcony of Europe to send out this message about the future of our history. But the true, original balcony of Europe is somewhere else. It's quite far away from here, actually, in geographical terms. It is at the border of Eastern Europe and Western Asia, deep in the Caucasus. There, the country Georgia, cherishing its persistent Western outlook, traditionally calls itself the balcony of Europe, maybe against all odds. A couple of years ago, the young female Georgian writer, Nino Haratishvili, burst upon the European literary scene with a book entitled Das Achterleben. Haratishvili's book is another European epic masterpiece, like Roger Martin Dugas's. It's built around different generations of a Georgian family and records contemporary European history and its endemic and saddening struggle with totalitarianism. Somewhere in the book, Haratishvili grapples with the balcony of Europe metaphor, to which her country so consistently holds on to. And Haratishvili calls this more or less official metaphor for her country ironic and poetic at the same time. A balcony enables you to have an outlook beyond one's own daily life and identity. At the same time, however, a balcony remains an isolated place. And when looking out from a balcony over Europe, it is history that meets the eye. And many of it is brutal history. A brutal history of geopolitics and the European appetite for expansion. A war cemetery, a mass grave, a gulag, or a killing field is never far away, and guilt is always present somehow. Our Europe counts numerous balconies. Some of these balconies are now located in the Europe of European integration. Others are at the rough fringes of the European Union, but they all are built on the enormous complexities of local histories, their glory and tragedy, their brute facts and delicate secrets. They are built on these stories in which time rules and politics and power become the psychological relation they in essence always remain. Imagine now that we would set off from these balconies of Europe now, at this very moment, and that we would fly like a bird or a fortnight warrior, if you like, over Europe. What would we see then? We would fly over contemporary European history and then deep dive in the histories that define the Europe of today, what would we discover and what would we see? The first thing we would see is the city of Paris, the city of love and deceit, ideas and art, resistance and cooperation, the city of feminine elegance and poetry in motion, the traditional modern example for every other European city of our times, the European capital par excellence, enlightened and romantic at the same time, the city of revolution, but also of ancien régime, and of course the city of dining, dancing, singing and swinging, this city where you may reflect and forget, learn and unlearn. At every balcony of Europe, without exception, example is taken from Paris. Tbilisi is called the Paris of Georgia. And here in our city, Usvik has been labeled the Quartier Latin of Maastricht. Even Boston and St. Petersburg want to mirror Paris. Seen from Europe's balconies, contemporary Europe is like Paris, traditional and trendy. But what is happening in the days of present-day Paris? What is happening in the Paris of our days, the Paris of today? Is there still something left of the hopes of the 1990s, Federica Mogherini remembered? What are the yellow jackets, les gilets jaunes, the gele hesjes, communicating? 3 years ago, on 13 November 2015, new and raw terrorist attacks hit Paris. 129 people died, of which 89 were shot in the Bataclan theater. Paris was in shock, again. Europe was in shock, again. Immediately after the attacks, there was a run on a book entitled A Movable Feast. A Movable Feast is a booklet from the famous American writer Ernest Hemingway. In the book, the young Hemingway recounts his adventures among the American community in Paris in the 1920s, working, partying, and growing up on the Rive Gauche. Their Paris of these Americans was an electrifying city where these American youngsters were caught in the black web of an ancient and amoral European culture, as they described it themselves. This was something very different from American dreams. But they loved it. But the scenery of their année folle was made up of the sinister aftermath of the unprecedented devastation of the Great War, World War I. The Europe they loved was a traumatized Europe, dangerously insecure and feverish. The Europe that turned a deaf ear to the politics of reconciliation of Gustave Stresemann and Aristide Briand, as well as to the lofty pacifism of Romain Rolland. This was the Europe that was captured by the German-Swiss painter Paul Klee in the 1930s in his painting Europa. A goddess still, but a goddess of despair and expressionism. In the dark Paris November days of 2015, buying the Hemingway memoir of his Paris years offered some strange sort of consolation. After the shocks of terror, the title and the subject of Hemingway's book, A Movable Feast, referring to Paris as a movable social gathering of wining and dining, appealed to the imagination. That is to say, to those who were frequenting the outdoor cafes again while the pavements around Bataclan were still stained with blood. It was illustrative for the unsettling mood in Paris and Europe. Europe was out of balance, staggering maybe, looking for support, surely, and again. And for this support, it looked west, again. In the winter of 2014, only 1 year before 2015, the victims of Maidan Square in Kiev had done the same, looking west for support. Georgia had done the same for the umpteenth time in 2008. But the West they hoped for, the European culture they felt part of, remained a phantom. This same seductive phantom, a beautiful phantom, which lingered above the bloody streets of Budapest in 1956, and above the Central European University of Mikhail Ignatieff until very recently. It remained a phantom. Looking back on that Paris autumn of 2015, only 3 years ago, we now may conclude that this probably was the last time in contemporary Western European history that this looking west for help happened so spontaneously and hopefully in Europe. Back then, in that autumn of 2015, in Paris, Brexit and President Trump were still in the making. Since then, we here in Western Europe are swiftly becoming more and more vulnerable, more Eastern Europe-like, whether we like it or not. The brute facts of history and geopolitics are simple as that. Indeed, much has happened since 2015. Future historians even may conclude that then, 2015, and now, 2018, are two worlds apart. Two worlds which together sketch the closing of an era, marking the phase of transition we are in right now. A transition in which the American century, this short but intense century of Americanization, transatlantic hopes and successes, this century in which present-day Europe was built, draws to a close. This begs questions. Which world are we leaving? What are we heading for? One of the fellow travelers of Hemingway in the Paris of the 1920s was David Bruce, a young and handsome descendant from a well-to-do American family, who would become the first American ambassador to post-war Paris in the 1940s. It was in the 1920s, however, that David Bruce, like so many Americans of his generation and class, had begun what his biographer described as his love affair with Europe. And Bruce's love affair with Europe reflects the outlook of a whole generation which stood at the start of the American century. Politically, the takeoff of the American century was marked by the active involvement of the American diplomacy in the peace negotiations after World War I in 1919. The US delegation to these negotiations in Paris included every young diplomat who could invent an excuse to be present at what has been called America's geopolitical coming out party. The young David Bruce, passionately interested in literature and people, was among them. And in these early 1920s, was then that David Bruce lost his heart to the French actress Yvonne Printemps, as he recalled in his diary in June 1949 when he was US ambassador to Paris. According to Bruce, Yvonne Printemps was, and I quote, the essence of femininity, representing the spirit of Paris, unquote. If Bruce had a mission in professional life, it was this: to guard the European spirit embodied by Yvonne Printemps, and hence to battle the poverty and hunger that terrified it before, during, and after the war. Just like so many of his friends and colleagues, Bruce saw that the Great Depression of the 1930s and the devastating inequality, nationalism, and racism it unleashed, that the Great Depression was a key cause for that horrific violence which raped Europe during the Second World War. And hence, that battling poverty in Europe was at the heart and should be at the heart of his mission and the mission of his generation. Their mission, which these Americans summarized as building Europe. What we may have forgotten is that in those days of the 1940s, the battle against poverty in Europe was also understood as a fight against unregulated capital markets. Or in the words of Henry Morgenthau, the US Treasury Secretary in the early 1940s, and I quote Morgenthau, "The task that the statesmen should set themselves is to drive the usurious moneylenders from the temple of international finance. The institutions of the new international order ought to be the instruments of sovereign governments and not of private financial interests," unquote. And indeed, capital controls would become the true and only backstop in the system of Bretton Woods. In the monetary union and the Eurozone of today, this essential part of the mission of building Europe may be very relevant again. And at the same time, This goes for the interlinked battle against monopolies and oligarchy, and the vested interests and inequality they nourish. These battles have been at the core of the founding of European integration, but seems to be less and less recognized as such. But now back to David Bruce. Bruce became the chief behind-the-scenes manager of the Marshall Plan. And from there, he developed into a very powerful facilitator of European integration through American ways and means during the 1940s, the 1950s, and the 1960s. First as the American ambassador to Paris, then as the American ambassador to Bonn, and then as the American ambassador to London. It was through men like Bruce that the American economy of abundance got connected to the hungry peoples and poor markets of Western Europe. And most crucially, that this coupling was enshrined in unprecedented treaties of transatlantic multilateralism. It was through men like David Bruce that the famous American cultural diplomacy worked, creating a stable Western Europe while experimenting with capitalism and democracy, embedded in Franco-German reconciliation and within international organizations, which were often explicitly linked to the rule of law and the promotion and practice of human rights. And the mission and experimenting of Bruce's generation brought unbelievable successes. Within that generation of Americans, David Bruce was the Don Draper of American diplomacy. This was a time in which America's madmen were still in diplomacy instead of in advertising. Fresh archival findings suggest that this American Europe was indeed more real than any other Europe during the crucial first decades after the Second World War. From Jean Monnet, the godfather of European integration, to Isaiah Berlin, the leading Cold War intellectual of the post-war West, the carriers of post-war Western Europe were sponsored by the Ford Foundation. And from Europe's trade unions and business circles to religious networks, yes, through numerous pan-Western networks like these, leading and influential Europeans got tightly interwoven with the emerging American Europe. Indeed, pre-1950 West multilateralism built a laboratory in which different initiatives for European integration were developed, long before the process of European integration, as we know it now, took root. What happened in this transatlantic laboratory was that ideas for a new order in Europe were tested and shaped through ongoing and still highly topical debates about the dilemmas of the free world capitalism, such as the dilemma concerning the balance between domestic economic stability and international economic stability, the dilemma of social cohesion and competitiveness, or the enduring problem of balance of payments and the possibilities and impossibilities of banking without banks. To a certain extent, institutions and systems like Lend-Lease, Bretton Woods, the IMF, the World Bank, the International Trade Organization, later the GATT and the WTO, the Marshall Plan, the Organization for European Economic Cooperation, the European Coal and Steel Community, its forerunner, the European Payments Union, and the European Common Market were all part of the same pan-Western quest for welfare and stability through resilient capitalism and democracy in Western Europe. And this all was linked to often truly transnational networks and lobbies, like the Action Committee for the United States of Europe, the World Council of Churches, and the Bilderberg Conferences, but there are a lot more. During the first phases of the post-war era, a transatlantic dream became true. Atlantis existed. But just like the Atlantis of the classics, it still has to be discovered. It's only since very recently that we are integrating detailed historical research on separate elements of and in this laboratory, and that archival, historical, political science, and economics research together delve into the history underneath the surface of European integration's day-to-day institutional development. And there, underneath the surface, deep diving towards the lost Atlantis, we find that European integration is a constant changing outcome, a constantly changing outcome of an ongoing battle of ideas concerning what Europe may or should become in the future. And this battle of ideas works across national frontiers and cross-cuts member states, as well as political parties. And crucially, no idea, no plan, no vision or grand design has ever been strong enough to continuously subordinate the alternatives to its institutional logic. This deeper reality, however, is a reality we have not yet seen clearly enough, and there is a reason. As from the beginning of European integration, a striking match existed between the emerging integration process on the one hand and the national economic and political goals its member states set themselves on the other. Goals like stability and welfare. And this striking match, this striking and surprising match between national interests on the one hand and European integration on the other, enabled governments of the member states of European integration to do something extraordinary, namely to claim that they were in control. But this is a fairy tale. What happened in reality was something rather different. The integration process that took off was beyond the control of single national governments. No capital could steer its course. In fact, every capital, in its own way, steered a quite erratic course in the matter of European integration, except perhaps for the Federal Republic of Germany. Im Nachhinein sind alle klüger. That is especially true for the member states of European integration. Until the present day, research has had serious difficulties to deal with these persistent national post-facto rationalizations of history. The writing of European history paradoxically still remains a national affair. And this is a decisive cause for the current state of research. We are only at the beginning of mapping out how the, in essence, trans-European political, economic, and institutional drift towards European integration worked, how it came about, how it evolved, and how it can develop in the future. For me personally, it is a great privilege to be actively involved in this frontline research from my chair in contemporary European history and European integration. I'm very grateful to Maastricht University for granting me this unique opportunity and to be able to work together in this undertaking with excellent scholars in the field at this truly European university. Next to that, I feel lucky that I can take on the challenges of this frontline research, also in cooperation with top-class colleagues from outside Maastricht, like the members of our NWO-funded blueprint research team in Utrecht, my colleagues at the WRR in The Hague, with my colleague Steven van Hecke from Leuven University in a very challenging new research project on European integration in cooperation with Cambridge University Press. And one of the things we are rediscovering through this research is that our post-war American Europe, in essence, might not have been much more than a flush of escapism. The other side of the escapism of Ernest Hemingway and David Bruce, so to say. An escape from politics and history for traumatized Europe into a more apolitical and comfortable sphere of policy, technocracy, and Anglo-Saxon management of market forces. An escape which almost seemed nothing less than a re-enlightenment sometimes after the medieval darkness of the first half of Europe's 20th century. But it also might have been, like every escape is in the end, a temporary fix. A temporary fix of geopolitics, idealism, and historic American self-confidence. And this implies that the American Europe never replaced the older European Europe. That from a European perspective, European integration was never more than a very successful form of management of decline for Europe's worn-out nation states. And indeed, the rape of Europe was never more benign than it was in the Western Europe of the post-war era. None of Europe's suitors has been more caring to her than the United States. Europe's abduction during the Pax Americana was like a dream come true. Indeed, the Western European successes of integration, peace and stability that were produced in parallel turned out very real. The collapse of the Bretton Woods system in the early 1970s marked the beginning of the suffocation of this transatlantic love affair. Yes, it marked the end of the coordinated Western world described as the system of embedded liberalism by the American political scientist John Ruggie. This system of Keynes at home and Smith abroad slowly but surely transformed into a system of market decontrol, an extreme liberation of financial markets in particular, after US President Richard Nixon had pulled the plug of capital control. Ironically, the historic Western victory of the fall of the Berlin Wall marked the definite end of the transatlantic love affair. And today we are struggling with accepting this new reality. We are looking for help. But when we look to the West now, what we see is a living reflection of the Roman goddess of Paul Klee. Compared to the Europe we had in the 20th century, what we see now sometimes look like a sort of post-Europe, an after-Europe, a post-Europe in which we are, for instance, effectively transforming the much-praised European tax state into a debt state and a society of borrowing, a society which borrows from the future and increasingly overshadows the European invention of the social state. Do we understand how we got here in the Europe of today? Maybe not. The Treaty of Maastricht was Europe's first effort to deal with this totally new situation of today, to cope with the transition from Pax Americana into a more European history again. And what do we see if we fly closer to that European Europe? Who do we meet there? I'll take a... Who do we meet there in that European Europe? After the horror of the Second World War, the Italian writer Curzio Malaparte longed to go back to Paris, the European city he loved most. And when he finally returned to Paris in the late 1940s, Malaparte went out to see his favorite actress, of course, the Russian-born French actress Vera Coren. There she is. But strangely enough, Malaparte had to admit to himself that he did not feel at home in Paris anymore. He kept a diary about his unsettling period, and in that diary he notes that Vera Coren was superior in connecting to Europe's spiritual motherlands, the lost Europe of Racine and Tasso, their romanticism, and the European virtues of forgiveness, resurrection, melancholy, and remorse. But he also notes that Coren was the only one left who understood this. Together with him, Malaparte, they were the last Europeans. In the 1940s, Paris was not Paris anymore. Maybe the people of the new time didn't understand that Malaparte was only interested in, and I quote him, ideas, literature, and art. Malaparte was a zealous and unconventional researcher of the zeitgeist. In his Europe, maddened by war and violence, the provocateur Malaparte often was considered a crank, an unreliable man. In short, somebody perfectly suited for journalism, war reporting, and high diplomacy. And that is what he was and did, crisscrossing the Eastern European bloodlands as a journalist diplomat, including dinners with Heinrich Himmler, excursions to the Warsaw Ghetto, and sinister fights and discussions with dead and half-dead human beings. And in his famous, scandalous novel, La Pelle, The Skin, Malaparte sketches a disconcerting picture of the liberation of Italy in 1943, in which he was involved as a liaison officer to the American Allied forces. In passing, Malaparte captures the essence, I think, of the sweet transatlantic clash of civilizations that still forms the basis of the post-war Europe of today. Malaparte explains that he loved his American colleague soldiers because they didn't understand anything of the dark and sinful Europe they were in. And I quote Malaparte, "Their souls are pure, much purer than ours. I like Americans because they do not know that without evil there can be no Christ." Unquote. In the terrible fall of 1943, Malaparte was unable to do without them, to do without these Americans. And I quote Malaparte again, "The pure and honest simplicity of their ideas and sentiments and the genuineness of their behavior instilled in me the illusion that men hate evil, the hope that humanity would mend its ways." Unquote. What the Americans had on offer was exactly what Europe had lost, hope and ideals. And like Malaparte in 1943, post-war Europe couldn't move forward without America and American hope. And post-Cold War Europe couldn't do without George Bush. But Europe's dependency on this American drug had consequences. It induced fundamental changes in Europe, the change Malaparte would feel in Paris already in the late 1940s. Ladies and gentlemen, when Malaparte was unhappy in Paris, Prague, the Czechoslovak capital, was on the eve of the 1948 coup d'etat, in which the Czech Communist Party, with Soviet backing, assumed control over the government, marking the onset of four decades of communist rule in the country. And in the communist Prague that emerged from this, the philosopher Jan Patočka ran the so-called underground university, as he was banned from teaching. Patočka's underground university was an informal institution in people's living rooms. What it tried to do was offer a free, uncensored cultural education, a European education. Here people could take part in an impressive attempt to live in truth, as Patočka's student Václav Havel recalled later. The Socrates of Prague, as Patočka was called, taught his students that history is not a story with a plot and a happy ending, but a relentless struggle against obfuscation through lies, against the absolutism of rationalization and consumerism, and against all those other human banalities that spell the end of inspiration and openness. He explained that Europe had to fight this struggle time and again, and that if it fails to do so, Europe will wallow in the delusion of pretense once again, pretending that simple solutions will make problems disappear, pretending that propaganda is art, pretending that propaganda is education or science. When the Berlin Wall came down, the former students of Jan Patočka's underground university probably knew more about the strengths and weaknesses of our open Europe of those days than we Western Europeans did. While we looked west, they tried to reinvent the West, rooted in the difficult but essential exercise to practice human rights. And they felt this was urgent because Patočka had prepared them for what he had called post-Europe, a further manifestation of the crisis of Western civilization, which in his days had manifested in itself in the form of socialist totalitarianism. However, at that moment of the signing of the Treaty of Maastricht, a fundamentally other Europe seemed to emerge, an other Europe than the post-Europe Patočka had warned for. And that Europe even seemed to make fun of its own contemporary history. Indeed, that Europe of the Treaty of Maastricht seemed to defy the very rules and laws of contemporary European history. Which were these rules? In November 1959, the philosopher Isaiah Berlin gave a long-forgotten lecture to the Third Congress of the Fondation Européenne de la Culture in Vienna. It was one of the exceptional moments when Berlin ventured to tackle the problem of European unity. His lecture was entitled European unity and its vicissitudes, its ups and downs, its kidnappings. In his speech, Isaiah Berlin addressed the issue of the constant ups and downs in Europe's unity. And in a key passage, he explains their dynamic. His words remain very topical today, and I quote Isaiah Berlin. European history is a kind of dialectic between craving for public order and for individual liberty. And he continued, the quest for order is a kind of fear before the elements, an effort to preserve the banisters that human beings need to prevent them from toppling over into an abyss, to connect them with their past and point the path to the future. But when institutions become too set and obstruct growth, order becomes oppression. And sooner or later, it is broken through by an almost physiological desire to live, create, by the need for novelty and change, unquote. This is a gripping description of the rhythm of European history. What Berlin captures here are the two souls of the West, of European culture, enlightenment and romanticism, reason and emotion, calculation and sentiment. And those two souls form the far ends in between which the pendulum of European history swings, from the one far end to the other and back again. And this pattern of ups and downs, vicissitudes, this swinging between reason and emotion, light and dark, revolution and ancien regime, is a pattern that fits the dominant concepts of 20th century thought, from the dialectics of Hegel and Marx to the creative destruction of Joseph Schumpeter. A pattern that tells us that any fundamental change must be accompanied by the violent breakup of the existing order. This may be what the yellow jackets are communicating. But it also seems to be a too simplistic scheme to catch the European 1990s, this diaphragm of contemporary European history, this lucky in-between from the fall of the Berlin Wall to 9/11, during which Europe's vicissitudes were suppressed in conversations and negotiations. Because back then, in the 1990s, there existed a broad consensus that the order of cooperation and reconciliation was not and would not become an oppressing one. On the contrary, the existing order was perceived and was believed to remain a freeing order, an order that would sabotage the pendulum of European history, a revolution without revolution. Indeed, what Europe tried to do with the Treaty of Maastricht was to explicitly step out of this maddening pendulum of European history, to bolster the institutions of cooperation that it had created during the American century so as to make them fit for the next century. But already in 1999, that future year in which the artist formerly known as Prince threw the best party ever, already in that year, 1999, the Polish philosopher and sociologist Zygmunt Bauman asked a pressing question, and I quote Bauman, how does it come about that the human ability to imagine a better world was not among the trophies of victory? Unquote. Bauman was referring to the unbelievable victory of the 1990s, the unbelievable European victory over its own history, and his question, why did we lose the ability to imagine a better world? The answer to this pressing question of Bauman might be that we got high again on a late but very powerful rush of the transatlantic intoxication that had characterized the second half of the European 20th century. A fresh rush of the primacy of policy and technocracy over politics, which also manifested itself in the European Monetary Union and enabled us to push back the daunting history of European politics once more, escaping history one last time, reveling in comfort, efficiency, and the endless policies of upscaling. ladies and gentlemen, if we want to protect the open spirit of the 1990s, instead of ridicule it, we have to work on it. To begin with, we have to start writing the history of the 1990s. The high hopes of the new Europe were made explicit here in Maastricht, but they are not very visible anymore, neither in media nor in politics. Too few know about the existence of these high hopes. They may even go underground in the future. And from this perspective, it is indeed very urgent that we start writing and archiving the history of the European 1990s. And it's up to us to research our Europe, the Europe that came into being after 1914, 1945, and after 1990 and 2016. It's up to us to research that Europe and assess it as critically as we can, test it, and in so doing, try to cherish that essential European lesson about the social condition, that man is powerless without others, and that where others are powerless, he is too. Ladies and gentlemen, it is exciting and great news that the city of Maastricht and the province of Limburg actively strengthen the scholarly work in this regard through the Europa Chair, thank you, Mayor, as well as through the European Heritage Label awarded to the Treaty of Maastricht. Personally, I'm deeply grateful for the confidence and support. All the more so since the challenges we will be taking up in our common organization are challenges in the true sense of the word. It is yet another privilege to co-coordinate the endeavor of further crystallizing the UN-wide European research agenda with my colleagues of the academic board of the project and the new managing director of Studio Europa. Alan, Clemens, Thomas, Peter, and Gonny, and of course Joop, Piet, Guido, André, Bart, Aline, Anne, and Annelies. And last but very far from least, director herself, Rianne, thanks a lot. We have achieved quite something already. And I'm looking forward to the next exciting steps, including the build-up of an archive in cooperation with Historisch Centrum Limburg and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Together with Lita, Bart, Bert, Niels, and in the background, Albert Kersten, who I want to thank for being my guide in the world of diplomatic history and the archives of Dutch foreign policy. Next to this, I'm also looking forward very much to further cooperation with strong and trusted partners like the Bali and Forum on European Culture. I want to thank you, Juri, and Anne Marijn especially, for the cooperation in the past years, and I'm sure we will continue our cooperation in many more daring projects. Ladies and gentlemen, I never had imagined going back home would be so special. I had actually never imagined that my work could be here in the streets of my youth. As from the first day that I started my work at University of Maastricht, it has been a truly overwhelming experience. Overwhelmingly full of opportunities, impressive colleagues in the broad field of European studies, history and philosophy, full of expectations also, full of turbulence and trust, and overwhelmingly full of family and old and new friendships. In fact, so full of these things that my whole new Maastricht experience got me staggering sometimes, almost literally. That I did not fall yet was also thanks to the great colleagues with whom I work, especially within the very professional and successful organization of the University College Maastricht. I want to thank them all for the collaboration and for what we were able to achieve during the past years. And I want to thank Sharon in particular for her support and super professional work. Ladies and gentlemen, I would not be here without the guidance of two intellectual mentors. It feels very special to me that my doktervater, Bob Lieshout, is present here today. Dear Bob, I want to thank you for my academic upbringing, which was essential for a young man passionately interested in literature and people. Yes, indeed, only interested in ideas, literature, and the art of football. Without your lessons, including introductions to the Scottish Enlightenment and the thought of Lakatos, I would not have become the scholar that I am now, not even close. Bedankt, Bob. My other intellectual guide is Max Koonsdam. Max lived Europe's longest civil war from the beginning to the end, and was one of the true builders of the present-day European Union. He passed away in the autumn of 2010. But in the years before his death, Max handed me over a treasure trove full of deep insights in Europe, human nature, and the world. His wisdom and life will remain a source of inspiration for me, and his personality an example. I'm very honored, humbled, and grateful that his family is present here today. Thank you. En dan tot slot de allerbelangrijkste dankzeggingen. Aan mijn familie en schoonfamilie. Aan mijn beste vrienden, Jeroen, Sander, Jim, Jos, Jeroen, Raoul en Roland in Skopje. Aan mijn ouders en mijn broers, van wie ik zoveel hou. En natuurlijk aan jullie, Sophia, Orfeo, Gloria en Marel. Mijn steun en toeverlaat en mijn grote liefde. Met jullie durf ik het aan, ook dit hoogleraarschap. Ik heb gezegd.
Always difficult to descend the stairs. Dear Professor Segers, dear Mathieu, many thanks for what I believe was a beautiful inaugural address. So rich that I think everyone would like to have the text as well. I think it's also good that we have a Christmas break coming up, so that we can also read up on many of the great names that you have referred to in your inaugural. Thank you so much. We are now at the end of this academic ceremony, and that means that we will be heading towards the famous mountain, the Minderbroedersberg, where Mathieu and his wife will have their reception. It's a huge crowd, so please don't stand in a queue because you will be standing outside in the rain. Go inside the room, have a drink, and find a proper time to congratulate Mathieu. And if you are also there in the evening, take that time instead of during the reception. I would also like to ask our guests on the first row to follow right after me, Mathieu and the Beadle, and then followed by the cortege. That means everyone here on the first row, and then my colleagues, professors, and then everyone else. Thank you so much for being here. I hope you have a wonderful weekend. Thank you very much.